Good morning, students. Today we are going to see the chapter 18, that is electronic data interchange. In the previous chapter we have learnt about how the electronic transaction happens, and the securities, various security levels, how to secure the electronic data transactions. And in this chapter we are going to discuss about what are all the methods involved in electronic data interchange. So these are the discussion points which we are going to discuss in this chapter. First we learn about the basic knowledge of EDI, that is the introduction part, and the advantages of the electronic data interchange EDI, and the various layers, what all the various layers available in the EDI, and the next about the various types of EDI, what all the various types available of EDI, how the data can be easily interchanged with the various medium. And the last one we are going to learn about the UN EDIFACT. First we start with the introduction to EDI. So the electronic data interchange mainly it transfers the business documents or any business transactions, business data, business related data between one source to another destination, that is one trade partner to another electronically. That is the main difference between the normal data transfer and this EDI. So mainly this it is a dedicated transferred through a dedicated medium, that is a dedicated channel, or through the internet, and it has a predefined format where it reduces the human intervention. So maximum it reduces the human intervention. Directly it sends the data to the receiver without any human intervention. In rare case it may include the help of human intervention. So that is the main advantage of this EDI. So because of this the security level gets increased, and also it is used to transfer the documents like delivery notes, invoices, purchase order, which is related to the supply chain management, starting from the manufacturing till the delivery of the product, and also all the functional acknowledgements, all the details will be sent to the through this EDI. So these documents are transferred directly from the computer of the issuing company, from one computer, from the sender, and it moves on to the receiver. So this is how, and the image you can able to see, they are requesting a purchase order from the buyer's system, and from the supplier they are sending back the invoice. So this is how the electronic data interchange occurs, and it mainly save more time, and it avoids many errors when compared to the on paper communication, that is the traditional communication. So that is a major advantage which they face, which the companies face, and they have found that it is very more convenient when compared to the on paper communication. And before the internet came, this on paper communication was a business model. After the evolution of the internet, this electronic data interchange plays a major role in the business organization and the business transactions. And EDI includes the data exchange between the buyers and sellers, even the trade partners, and even for internal data exchange within the organization. So there are so many purposes has been fulfilled with the help of this EDI. And there are various standards, that is protocols available like EDIFACT, XML, ANSI, ASC, X12. So all these are various standard based on their countries, they have developed EDI standards. So this is all about the introduction to the electronic data interchange. Next one we are going to see what are all the various types of EDI available, that is the various medium, how the data can be easily transferred. So the EDI types is mainly developed based on the communication connection and also the conversion where they organize. So how the data is transferred, so in which all the medium it can be transferred. So based on that this EDI type has been developed. So the first one's direct EDI, that is the point to point EDI, one to one communication, and the EDI via WAN, that is a value added network, an intermediate will be there. And next one is EDI via FTP or VPN, or a secured file transfer protocol, that is SFTP, and also web EDA and mobile EDA is all these five types are there. So now let us see one by one. And first one is the direct EDA. This direct EDA can also be called as a point-to-point EDA, and it mainly establishes a direct connection between the business stakeholders, that is the sender and the receiver, individually. That is the main difference between the other EDA with this direct EDA. This type of EDA is mainly suitable for larger business, because they do lot of transaction day-to-day activities. They do a lot of transaction, business transactions on daily basis. So these direct EDA is mainly suitable for the larger businesses. And the next one is EDA via WAN, that is a value added network. An intermediate network will be there. You can able to see the diagram. In the left diagram, in the left you can able to see the sending company, and the right side you can able to see the receiving company. In the intermediate, you can able to see the EDA network service provider, that is a various third party network service providers are there, trusted network service providers. So based on the agreement or the contract, what they have done with the, based on the privacy, so they share the data with the intermediate network service providers. So for, and also to reduce the complexities, because the network technology is growing day by day, and to reduce the complexity level, and they have shared the network service provider to the third party companies. So based on the, many business prefer this network model to protect them from the updating ongoing complexities of the network technology, because they no need to get updated, and they can more concentrate more on their business rather concentrating on this network updates. And the third party network service providers will focus on the data transfer with the high security. So this is EDA via WAN, that is a value added network. And next one is the EDA via FTP or VPN, that is a file transfer protocol or virtual private network, or it can be secured file transfer protocol. Both SFTP and the FTPS are same, that is a secured file transfer protocol, and otherwise it can be called as file transfer protocol secured. These are the protocols which is mainly used for transferring the documents, and there are various third party cloud storage available for holding all the data, that is using the file transfer protocol. And this is how this EDI, the electronic data interchange, happens with the help of this file transfer protocol. There are so many companies having the cloud storage to store the company's data. And with the help of that cloud storage, they automatically transfer with the help of this protocol, and they transfer directly from the cloud storage to the receiver company. Like that, the files get transferred within the company or to the other companies. And the last two are the web EDA and mobile EDA. So web EDA is nothing but the web-based EDA uses the web browser for transferring the data. And whereas the mobile EDA uses smartphones or any other handheld devices to transfer the documents. So that is the major difference between the web EDA and the mobile EDA. So these two made the business more easy and convenient, and it is more suitable for small and medium organization, because they do not want to invest more amount on this data file transfer, and they no need to concentrate more on the technologies. And since it is very user friendly, both web based and mobile EDA, it is very easy and convenient for the small and medium organization. So these are the two last two types of EDA, that is web EDA and mobile EDA. And also when compared to the web based, the mobile EDA has more speed in transferring of the data. So the EDA transaction occurs in a fast manner. So that made more easy and convenient for the business organizations. Next one is the advantages of the EDA. So EDA was mainly developed to solve the problem that are present in the paper-based transaction processing. And also in other form of electronic communication, they face so many issues and errors and security issues. So for overcoming these problems, the EDA concept has been developed. So implementing the EDA system offers a company or a business greater control over its supply chain, as a supply chain, we told that starting from the manufacturing and also all the purchase details, inventory details, or starting from the manufacturing till the delivery of the product. So all the details are get easily tracked, and it makes the profit and it makes the concentration on the trade more effectively. So that is the main advantage of the CDA, and also it increases the productivity and promotes the operation efficiency. The following are the other advantages of the EDA, that is it improves the service to the end users, since the transactions and the data are transferred in a high secure manner and fast manner. So the end users feels that service has been improved, and also it increases the productivity for the business, and it minimizes the errors, and the main thing, it reduces the response time very fast. And it reduces the response time. Automation, it do the operation, the process automatically. So automation of operations has been done, and reduces the cost of investing in on paper communication. And it integrates all business and trading partners. So all these are the other advantages of the EDA. Next, we are going to see about the ED layers, that is electronic data interchange layer, how the architecture of the data interchange is divided into, and there are four layers. First one is semantic layer. So in this layer, all the business, it is a application level service, and all the business applications will be defined, how the business application should be, how the format should be. So all the semantic definition will be made in this semantic layer. And next one is standard translation layer. So in this, all the business form standards will be given, all the EDIFAC standards will be mentioned. So all the standard related details will be given in this standard translation layer. And the third one is transport layer, the how the business form, how the business data is to be get transferred from one system to another. So in which method, and in which type, in which EDIFAC type. So all the types will be defined here. And the last one is the physical layer, all the physical components like internet connection or mobile devices or whatever physical components we use for the data transfer. So all these will be mentioned in the physical layer. So these are the four layers which are involved in this EDIFAC, that is electronic data interchange architecture. So the next topic we are going to see is AD components. So there are four major components involved in the EDIFAC or the electronic data interchange. And the first one is the standard document format, where all the standards, AD standards, will be mentioned in the document, and how the format, document format should be, how the data format should be predefined. And next one is the translator and mapper. So it translates the standard AD standards, and mapper is nothing but it tracks all the information, and the communication software, what are all the software we are going to use for the data transfer, and communication network. So how the communication is going to be built, how the network is going to be built with the help of the software. So with the help of the software and hardware. So that will be mentioned in the communication network. So these are the four major components of the EDI. And next one is the EDI standard. That is, the standard is the most critical part of the EDIFAC, that is the electronic data interchange. Since we told that the electronic data interchange is full and full data transmission and the information exchange in the form of an agreed message format. We have already told that there will be a specific format for the data to be transferred, and based on the format, the data will be transferred from one system to the another. So likewise, for this agreed message format, they have developed a common EDI standard, that is a unified standard. And the EDI standard mainly divided into various categories, starting from the basic standard till the security standard. So it has some basic standards, even the code has standards, even the message, what all the message to be given in the data transmission has standards, and document standard, management standard, application standard, the communication standard, how the data is to be communicated, what role the network, in which this network, this kind of data should be transmitted. So all the communication standards, and the last one is security standard. So likewise, there are various standards has been created, So based on the level of the security and the data, the standards can be selected. And the first industry specific standard was the TDCC, that is mainly for Transportation Data Coordinating Committee in 1975. After that, they have developed based on that standard as a basis. They have that standard and developed so many standards based on their industry needs. Say for example, WINS. WINS is mainly developed for warehousing industry. So for warehousing, they have created a specific standard. Likewise, they have created so many standards based on their industry. So and overall, for they have created a common standard in the American National Standard Institute Accredited Standard Committee, that is ANSI ASC. So that is a common standard mainly developed in America, and they have by seeing that they have in Europe, they have created another ID standard, that is GTDI, that is Guideline for Trade Data Interchange. So like this, based on their country's norms and regulations, rules and regulations, they have created various ID standards. And on the whole, a common standard has to be created. So and as a like an international standard. So like that, they have planned to create a common standard, that is United Nations Economic Commission for Europe. So the next topic we are going to discuss is UN EDIFACT. It is a international standard, that is a common standard which is applicable for all type of industries, that is UN EDIFACT, that is United Nations Electronic Data Interchange for Administration, Commerce and Transport. So it is an international EDI, and it is the standard developed under the supervision of the United Nations. So it is directly supervised by the United Nations, and it can be applicable for all type of industries. And also it is a cross industry standard, because it is not an industry dependent. So any type of industries can just apply this standard. And this EDIFACT includes a set of internationally agreed standards or some catalogs and guidelines for the transferring or exchanging the data of that is exchanging the structured data electronically between the independent system, not a dependent system, it is independent system, that is the main advantage of this. And it is directly monitored or supervised by the United Nations Center for Trade Facilitation and Electronic Business, that is UNCFACT. And this is which is directly affiliated to the UN Economic Commission for Europe, which was already we have told that that was a international standard. Based on that, it is affiliated this EDIFACT, this UN EDIFACT. And the next topic is EDIFACT directories. So the EDIFACT directories is nothing but the versions of the EDIFACT, we call it as a directories. So the various versions of the EDIFACT, we name it as a directory. So these EDIFACT directories will be revised twice a year. First thing, the 1st of April, and the second time is the 1st of October. So these in these updates, they will be they can update the existing EDIFACT version, or they can create a new EDIFACT version. And the versions, the EDIFACT directories have the names like D.18B. So the D stands for directory, and 18 is the year, and the A or B depends mentions the first of or the second of, that is the first revision or the second, that is first of October. Either if it is revised in 1st of April, means A will be mentioned. If it is revised in the 1st of October, means it will be mentioned B. So this is how they name it as a name the versions of the EDIFACT directories. The next topic is EDIFACT subsets. So we have already told that enormous number of data is transmitted or transferred from one system to another. So for avoiding the complexity, they have created a branch specific subset for each and every industries. So for example, based on the functions of the industry, they have segregated the industry types. So for example, for chemical industry, it is CFIC, and for gas business, AD gas, and for furniture, like AD fern. Like that, they have created a segment or a group of codes. So based on that, based on the functions of the industry, they can easily create the directories, and the complexity will automatically get reduced. When the number of data transmission gets splitted to each and every segment, means automatically the complexity get reduced. And the next one is EDIFACT structure. So how the EDIFACT is to be developed, how the structure is to be. So EDIFACT has a hierarchical structure starting from the top level to the lower level. So where the top level refers to an interchange where the data transmission occurs, and the lower level is the nothing but the which contains the multiple messages, that's the exact content what the data is to be transferred. And this is the last element, that is the data element, which will be available in the lower level. And the interchange occurs in the top level. So this is how the EDIFACT structure will look like. And now let us see how the EDIFACT structure works, starting from the highest level till the lowest level. So here you can able to see the EDIFACT structure, the hierarchical structure, starting from the highest level, that is the first one, interchange, and the last one is the data elements, the lowest level. So first, the lowest level, it is a single data. Each of a single data will be available in the simple data elements at the first level, and it moves on to the it combines based on the related simple elements, that is a composite element. It combines the related simple element into a single, and based on that the segment will get created. It is a combination of both the simple and the composite elements. And based on that, the segment group will be created. The similar segment will be grouped into a various types. So it relates the data, and also it relates the segments. That is, say for example, the functionalities of the industry, like that, the groups will be created, and the messages will be given through the segment groups. And the messages must be start with UNH and must end with UNT, that is the indication. So this is how the EDIFACT messages will be sent. And next, it move on to the functional groups. And the functional groups will share the initiation of the data transfer, will start the initiation for the data transfer, and where the data piece of data will be mentioned within the segments, starting from UNG and it ends with UNE. And last, the interchange, the data transfer occurs. That is a piece of data between the segments. That is, it will starts from UNB and UNZ. So these are the codes, these are the various codes, code indication. So with this code indication, it is understood that the data is in this level, the data is in the interchange level, the highest level, or the data is in the functional group, or with the data is in the message group. Like that, we can easily identify with these unique codes. So for that purpose, these codes are used. So the next topic which we are going to discuss is AD separators. So AD separators are used mainly in the messages that are transferred within the from lowest level to highest level. Say for example, the apostrophe, single apostrophe is used to for a segment terminator. It is used to terminate the segment, and the next segment starts with after the apostrophe. And plus sign is used to separate the segment tag and the data element. So like that, there are various separators, that is the punctuation marks, are used in the messages that are transferred from lowest level to highest level. So with this, the chapter 18, the electronic data interchange, gets completed. So and in this chapter we have seen about how the electronic data is get transferred. So how the data is transferred electronically, and what are all the various types, what all the various mediums can be used for transferring the data electronically, and various standards, what are the various standards available, how they have created based on the industries, and how they have developed the common standard, that is the international standard, and how the structure of the standard will be, that is the hierarchical structure starting from the highest level to the lowest level. So all these we have discussed in this chapter 18. Thank you, students.